Thank you so much. You know what? Let's just get into it because when I've told my coworkers and friends I'm going to speak to you, of course, everyone had a load of questions, but we're going to keep it simple because I know you're close, tight on time.
So tell me though, what did your friends say? I mean, give me the range of reactions. Like, give me the good, bad, and the ugly.
Well, the first question is, why start with the penis? Which, yeah, I mean, that's a valid question because that's a sensitive part of the body. So why don't we start with that? Why start there?
I mean, what do men care about more than anything else?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
I mean, no, I'm like, of course, there's like the headlines and there's the joke, but legitimately, you know, when a man's ability to be erect and to have a healthy sexual life is really important. And if a man cannot become erect and cannot have sexual intercourse, it is psychologically debilitating. It is, you know, a source of shame and embarrassment. And it's sad that we can't openly talk about it. And I'm hoping to punch on this taboo and say, you know what, we can talk about it. And we can actually talk about the therapies that have evidence that actually do help people who have needs.
Gotcha. And what do you think is the best response to, I mean, one of the questions that a lot of people have is, why are you doing this personally? Because the question that I got was, is he afraid of dying?
Yeah.
And I think that's a valid question because most people are afraid of death because it's the unknown.
Yeah.
How would you respond to that?
I would respond with, let's imagine that we are living a few hundred years ago. And we see a pattern in society that a whole bunch of people are dying who have surgeries or who have babies, and no one knows why they die, why the death rate is so high. And then someone discovers something called bacteria. It's like, hey, there's this stuff we can't see, and it's causing infection and death. And people are like, that's nuts. Like, that's, you know, whatever. That's voodoo talk. And then it turns out to be true that actually, if you have good sanitization practices of washing the hands and sterilizing the area, that you actually can dramatically save a lot of lives, and people don't need to die unnecessarily. So in that moment, you know, like, you would be rooting for your friends and family of like, oh, please, like, please pay attention, investigate this thing. It's really important. And I'm proposing something right now, that an idea from the future. I'm saying that death has always been inevitable. That's been true for Homo sapiens. We know that. Everyone's died. For the first time in the history of Homo sapiens, we can say with a straight face that death may no longer be inevitable, or that we just don't know how long and how well we can live. We've given birth to baby superintelligence, and it's moving faster than we can comprehend. So it is the first time you can say with a straight face, with science behind you, hey, it's not crazy to say this. And that's what I'm saying, is that we are at this special moment in time where we are transitioning as a species from this idea that we're just going to die, so we might as well live it up, to we don't know how long and how well we can live. Therefore, don't die becomes our only priority.
Gotcha. Okay. And that actually is a great question, leads to a great question, because a lot of people look at the longevity thing as just not dying, but it's actually more about living a fuller, healthier life, right? It's not just, I want to make it to 140. I want to make it to 140 with all of my faculties.
Yeah. So the reason why I say don't die, because the common response is, hey, that's a negative. Say it to be positive. Like, say, let's live long, or let's live well, or like, you know, whatever. I say don't die is because we as a species sometimes have a difficult time cooperating on a variety of things. So you give any topic that arises, you hear almost an infinite number of opinions on the given thing. We have a very hard time agreeing. You know, the one thing we all agree upon every single day is don't die. Like, each one of us, before we walk across the street, we look both ways. You know, when the smoke alarm is beeping because the battery needs to be changed, we change it. When there's mold on our food, we throw it out. If you and I were in a conversation right now and something was threatening your life or threatening my life, we would not say, nope, doing a podcast means we're living life. We would bail. We'd be like, you know what? Let's not die as first priority.
Right.
Every single one of us, you know, with a few exceptions of those who are, you know, on the brink of suicide, basically have don't die as their number one priority in existence. Nothing is more important to them than don't die. So it's a game everyone plays already. We already do it. And my endeavor has basically just said, we are going, the future is simply getting extraordinarily good at not dying, which is what we've been doing in society. So what I'm saying is we've been doing this for centuries. We're just going to get a lot better. So it's actually not that big of a revolution. We're just going to get better at something we already do.
Gotcha. I was looking at the blueprint before our meeting, and I actually want to try it. But you mentioned in previous interviews that an algorithm is controlling your daily life. Is that still true? And how do you see AI playing a role in longevity and health?
Okay. Yep. I'll give you... here's a story that explains that concept. A fleet captain is on their ship and gets a radio in, change course 20 north. Captain radios back and says, you change 30 south. Gets a radio back, immediately change course 30 or 20 north. And the captain at this point is irritated. Now, their authority's been challenged, like, God damn it. And so gets back on the radio. I'm fleet commander so-and-so of whatever. Change course 30 south. And they get a radio back, I'm a lighthouse, change 20 north. Now in that moment, the captain, this is a joke where, like, we're both going along in this thought experiment. We assume that the whatever he's communicating with is a ship. We don't think it to be a lighthouse. And the captain has always used their authority in their mind to overpower and bully everything in existence. Now, in that moment, the captain should have just hit autopilot. And the autopilot would have looked at all the data on the ocean and the sea and lighthouse and the rocks, and the autopilot would have been much better at doing that. And so the key here is that when technology improves to a certain degree, it gets much better and it augments our abilities to achieve a given task. And what I'm saying is, for the longest time, we could be captains of our ship and make all these little decisions here and there. Right now, we're in a different reality, and it's much better for us to hit autopilot. And that's what I've built, is an autopilot for my health, because it does a better job for me. And the days where we use our mind to overpower or seem to overpower, but the future is a lighthouse. It's something that we're just not going to beat.
And when you look at the blueprint, and I recall in a previous interview that you had said that it's going to be put out for free to the general public. Is that correct?
It already is. I shared the entire protocol. Yeah, everything I do is shared at no cost.
So what do you think are what do you envision as the broader implications of releasing this information to the public? Do you see it becoming something that the average worker, the average person can do, the average middle class, low income, even people could do themselves?
Everybody. So I'll tell you what I've done in the past. I built a payments company, Braintree, Venmo. And one of the problems we solved in the early days of ride sharing is it used to be the case you would hail a taxi cab, arrive at your destination, they'd pull out a janky machine, you pull out your credit card, and like, it may work, it may not work. It was a terrible experience. Everyone hated it. And with this rideshare company, we made it so that somebody held a car, you get in the car, you arrive at your destination, and you leave, and payment just went away. You no longer had to deal with payment. It just happened like magic. And that's what we're trying to build at Blueprint, is we're trying to make health and wellness like magic. You just don't even know. It just is built into the fabric of society. And so the Blueprint is not to chastise anyone to say, you know what, you're not doing a good job, or like, you need to be more self-disciplined or whatever. Society is unfair right now. It pits all of its godlike powers against the individual to make them addicted to everything. And what I'm saying is, this is silly, guys. Like, this is harming all of us. So let's make perfect health like magic. And so Blueprint is trying to build up the infrastructure for me initially, for others, and now for societal level, is like, it just makes sense that everyone is doing this as a norm.
That reminds me of an interview you gave earlier this year where you were basically saying that people should stop destructive behaviors as the first thing that they should do. Like, instead of, you know, just start working out, or stop not working out would probably be a better way to put it. So is it because, like, you know, I have my water right here, and I don't drink alcohol anymore. So that's just how I try to do better. But is it simple things like that, or are we talking more extreme cases of, like, you use the Ezra full body scan machine? Yeah. I'm going to be doing that later this next month.
Good for you.
And so, should I be doing that too, or is it just these simple changes in my life that can help me live longer?
Yeah, you can get the majority of the benefits in longevity. You can extend your life by over 20 years, get to average age 92 if you do five things. One, if you don't smoke. Two is if you do at least over 1 hour of exercise every week, a vigorous exercise, get your heart rate above, 120, 150, depending upon your health level. Three, if you eat a blueprint-like diet. Four, if you have alcohol in moderation, you don't have excessive alcohol. And five is if you have a BMI, a body mass index between 18.5 and 22.5. With those five basic things, you get over 20 years of lifespan extension.
And then how does sleep play into this? Because I know that there's been a debate about the length of sleep versus the quality of sleep. What's your view on that? Like, is there a sweet spot that we should be aiming for?
Yeah, I would say the thing that I do that I think is different is I've built my life around sleep. It is my number one life goal. Nothing is more important to me than sleep. And it's almost like when you get instructions in the airplane, put your mask on before you put the mask on for others. Because if you put on other people's mask, you're going to pass out and you're useless. So if you want to be helpful to yourself and others, you have to put your mask on. Your mask is getting high quality sleep. So I plan when I eat, I plan my social events, I plan my work schedule, I plan everything around sleep, which is exactly the exact opposite of what society does, where right now sleep is like the thing that can always be squeezed. You can always binge watch. You can always stay up late with your friends. You can always skip on sleep. Pull an all-nighter to do this work project or school project, whatever. But yeah, that's the thing I've done is I've made it my number one life priority. I just posted 8 months of perfect sleep using the wearable Whoop. And no one thought that was possible. And so, I don't know, am I the best sleeper in the world? I don't know. I'm a competitor for it.
Well, that's it. I've heard that a lot, like speaking to doctors and things, that just sleep helps with stress. It helps with, just being able to think more clearly and things like that. Are there any misconceptions that, because I mean, you hear it a lot, I'm sure. You get it on the internet all the time, people criticizing what you're doing. But what do you hear the most? And what's the one thing that you hear that you'd like to dispel about what you're doing?
Nothing. I have nothing to prove. I'm not on the defensive. I'm having more fun than I've ever had in my entire life. Like, I love this game. I love the banter. I love the criticism. I love the hate. Love it. It's just so much fun. It's so amazing to be alive. I'm so happy to be alive. And, I've been in really bad spots before. Like, I've wanted to take my life. I was depressed for 10 years. So I know what it's like. I don't hold anything against anyone. Like, it's tough to be out there and be a human. So, No, I'm having the time of my life. And, the more time I get to spend doing this endeavor, the more time I get to know people and they correctly understand my intentions. I know the headlines lead people to think of things of me that are inaccurate. And that's okay. We can go on this journey together and we'll find out who each other are in time. But no, I'm great. You're great. This is going to be a good time together.
Awesome. Were there any challenges getting started? Like, I know a few things besides the most famous thing you've tried. you did blood plasma.
Yeah.
You did the shock therapy. Were any of those more successful than others, or how did that work out?
I think the coolest thing we did was this plasma. I gave my dad, my 70-year-old father, 1 liter of my plasma. Mm. He had 600 milliliters of his plasma removed. It reduced his speed of aging by 25 years. So that means when every day we age, every day we get a little closer to death. And the older you get, the faster you age. And so my father went from aging at the speed of a 71-year-old to the age of a 46-year-old with 1 liter of my plasma, and that effect persisted for 6 months. It was a dramatic change in his life. And so even though I didn't personally experience any benefits, because my donor was my 17-year-old son, and then I had another donor who was 20 years old, there just wasn't that big of a difference between my health levels and their health levels. So it's just no effect. Whereas with my dad, it was a huge difference. So I know it's a scandalous headline. I know it's like a wild concept. But for my dad, like, man, he is a different human. It's pretty cool to see.
Are there any technologies you're looking at right now besides AI that you think can benefit what you're working on?
We just completed my first longevity gene therapy. And we just got results back. So I did a gene therapy for the increased levels of follistatin, which is a protein, and higher levels of follistatin have been shown to lessen the speed of aging. So you age slower, reverse epigenetic age, rejuvenate a whole bunch of organs. And we just got data back to show that my levels were increased by 160%. So it's working. And now we start seeing the data run. So yeah, now we're playing with gene therapy. We're doing all kinds of advanced therapies. I just did 100 million mesenchymal stem cells from young Swedish bone marrow. And yeah, so we're very excited. We're really trying to push the bounds. Like, I currently, my speed of aging, to simplify this, for every 12 months, I only age 8 of 12 months. I get 4 months for free. That's how much I've slowed my speed of aging. Now, other people, if you're not taking care of yourself, you could be aging 1.1 or 1.2. So for every 12 months that passes, you may be living the equivalent of, you know, aging the equivalent of 14, 15, 16 months. And so, the speed of aging is a real thing. And so when you see people who look great for their age, that's good evidence. And people who don't look that great, that's evidence of speed of aging.
Gotcha. All right, last question. We've all adapted the blueprint. It's in everybody's house and everybody's hand. Is there any downside to everyone living longer, in your opinion?
It reminds me of the problem when horses were the primary mode of transit in New York City. And there was so much manure in the streets of New York that everyone, like, it just was bringing society to a halt. The Hudson was polluted, and everyone thought the society was going to come to an end. And then Henry Ford invented the Model T, and horses went away as a problem. Oftentimes, the problems we think are problems are not actually problems. New technology comes along and solves those problems, and then it creates new problems. So the question before us is, what real problems do we actually have? And right now, the one I think we all acknowledge we have is death. That's the thing that's inevitable for all of us right now. And if we can agree on that basic premise, then we can build up from there. But this is a moment in history. Like this, if we can sober up and realize we are baby steps away from potentially the most extraordinary existence in the galaxy, this is our moment. And it'd be silly of us to give that up for some cheap thrills of pizza and alcohol and smoking and, you know, insert your vice. Like, this is our moment to shine. I think we should do it.
I remember you saying something about not liking the idea of pizza. what's wrong with pizza?
Oh man, that's awful. So if I ate pizza, I would feel sick. My sleep would be annihilated. The next morning, I'd be grumpy. I would be snippy, and I would hate myself for having eaten the pizza. The consequences are so severe because I'd feel so terrible. I just can't stand the thought of eating pizza.
Gotcha. Oh, wow. It's just the thought of it. It puts you off from wanting.
Yeah, it's like 48 hours of misery. You know, it's really painful. Yeah, it's almost like a bad food hangover where I have to deal with the effects of it for so long. It's awful. It's not even worth, you know, and the high you get from pizza, just like, it's not even that good, right? It's like you get maybe 2 or 3 seconds of the flavors hitting the mouth, and then it's just all downhill from there.
Yeah, and if you're lactose intolerant, it really isn't a party.
Exactly, yeah.
Awesome. Well, Bryan, thank you so much for taking the time. I really appreciate it.